think if we could have our beautiful head of community, Khadija, cut the music, we'll get started. Ooh, that was the kind of results you expect. So hello, everyone. Please keep introducing yourself to the chat, but I am going to get started. So hello and welcome to this Spotlight webinar on parental engagement. My name is Mariah O'Mara. I am the head of media here at HundrED. HundrED is a global education nonprofit based out of Finland, where I am now. And I first want to thank you all for joining us here today to talk about this very important topic. And I want to thank our great speakers for taking the time. They're very busy doing very important things, but they've got some really incredible things to share with us today. So before I pass it off to them, I'm going to go over a few housekeeping things and then really ground us by introducing this project. So first, as people will invariably ask, this session is being recorded and the recording will be shared. So no worries if you come in late or if you want to just save some things for later. And then please feel free to drop your questions into the Q&A box or in the chat at any time. We will have a designated session for Q&A at the end. So if we do not get to your question, feel free to tweet at us using the hashtag FamilyEngagement, or you can email us at research@hundred.org. So with that, I will get started. So as we all know, the COVID pandemic has caused unparalleled disruption in schooling around the world and has impacted learning for more than 1.5 billion students. So these changes have really forced all of us to reconceptualize our approaches to teaching and learning and thrust parental and family engagement to the center of all school activities in a way that we've never seen before. So in this unprecedented moment in which parents are becoming newly engaged with education, HundrED, together with the Center for Universal Education at the Brookings Institution, IDEO, and Kidsburgh, are aiming to bring together innovative collaborators to help identify, share, and facilitate the use of promising new strategies to build stronger school, family, and teacher-parent partnerships on both a local and global level. So in this session, each partner will explain a little bit more in detail their role in this project. But for this webinar, we've got a dual purpose here. So we hope that after today's session, you've not only learned a little bit more about the topic, but will really be inspired to champion this cause in your own communities. So either by sharing what you have learned today with those in your context, or by sharing with us what you're working on in your communities. So with that, it is my pleasure to introduce our first speaker, Lauren Ziegler. So Lauren is the Project Director for Education Innovation at the Center for Universal Education at the Brookings Institution. Lauren works to advance action-oriented research and policy guidance that works to ensure all children and young people around the world have access to 21st century education. This includes her work in the Family Engagement and Education Project, which has surveyed 25,000 parents and caregivers around the world and encompasses a network of about 41 project collaborators across 10 countries seeking to generate more effective school-family relationships. She has a background in education and international development and has worked in more than 20 countries with a focus on North America, Sub-Saharan Africa, and Asia. So with that, Lauren, welcome to the virtual stage.
Thanks so much, Mariah. It's such a pleasure to be here and great to see everybody from around the world. Really excited about this collaboration with HundrED, IDEO, and Kidsburgh, and I'm really excited to tell you a little bit more about the research that we've been doing. So I'm gonna pull up my screen here and just get us into slideshow in just a moment. All right, here we are. So we wanted to share some insights from our global study on parent engagement. And what I wanted to do first was kick it off right away and talk about definitions. So you'll hear me and probably the other panelists use both the terms parent and family. We kind of use them interchangeably. And what we mean here is the primary caregiver who assumes the responsibility for the health and the well-being of the child. We know that that isn't always the mother and the father. And we recognize that family is a much more inclusive term. So we use both. And then when we talk about engagement, we like to use Larry Furlazzo's definition of parent engagement as something that's really two-way communication. It really involves the parents. It's not just directed from the school to parents, but really is about, you know, genuine partnerships. And then, of course, the why. So, you know, why are we interested in parent engagement? Well, we know from the academic literature that when parents are engaged in their child's education, when they're working with schools, when they're helping kids, you know, in academic, you know, opportunities at home, that this really does have an impact on the child's academic and socio-emotional development. And then, of course, you know, as Mariah mentioned up top, COVID has really changed everything about education. And so we know that parents are really getting great insights into their child's education, whether it's through the Zoom classroom, or maybe it's SMS or radio programming, or unfortunately, in some corners of the world, it may be the lack of education as remote learning hasn't been able to continue. And so parent engagement is really top of mind. And we know that there are, as we're seeing in our research, parents are demanding new forms of parent engagement. So I'll get to that in a moment. So we're really thrilled to be conducting some research that we've been doing over the last year with a wonderful group of project collaborators from around the world. We're working in 10 countries, and our project collaborators are everywhere from a district level, an individual school district, to the country level. And so we're thrilled that, you know, through these project collaborators, we've been able to survey 25,000 parents and really hear, you know, what are parents' beliefs about education? What are they thinking about in this time, as well as education more generally? And I'm excited to get into some of those findings with you today. So these are the themes that we are starting to surface from our parent surveys, as well as the focus groups that we've conducted. And I'm going to walk you through each one. So the first was purpose of education. We asked a question on our survey about, you know, what do you think is the most important purpose of education? And we gave parents four options. One was helping students develop self-knowledge and a personal sense of purpose. Another option was preparing students for post-secondary education, preparing students to be good citizens, and preparing students for the workforce. And then when we looked at the jurisdiction level, we saw certain preferences by community. It's sort of interesting to see that many communities, many jurisdictions, 9 in total, parents felt that the most important purpose was developing a sense of self-knowledge. Some thought post-secondary education was the most important, and 2 communities in India thought that preparing students to be good citizen was most important. And you'll see that no jurisdictions really prioritize preparing students for the workforce as the most important purpose. So it's quite interesting to see. And then with that, one of the questions that we're thinking about now is, you know, what are the ways that educators and schools can understand parents' aspirations and motivations for sending their children to school? And we would love, if you're working on this and if you're doing innovations and you have solutions, please consider submitting them to the 100 Spotlight, because we'd love to know. And so a second theme that's emerging here is on innovative pedagogy. And in particular, we're finding that parents are really demanding these new forms of education. They're really interested in, you know, these types of innovative and interactive learning that can help children get to the 21st century education that we hope that they can have. On our survey, we asked a question. It was a live phone call survey, so people were read a scenario, but you kind of see what it would look like graphically. So there was one school in which, you know, children were sitting in groups, they were working on a group project, and the teacher was walking around asking questions. And then there was another scenario where there was a school, you know, in desks were in rows, and the children were taking notes and listening to the teacher. And we asked parents what type of school they would prefer. And you can see that overwhelmingly there is a preference for, you know, the classroom that's more interactive, where the innovative pedagogy is being used, but still some parents did prefer more traditional methods. So one of the questions that we have for you and would like to throw out there is, what are the ways that educators and schools and those involved in education can learn about and really understand parents' preferences and values around pedagogical approaches so that we can be introducing more innovative pedagogy in the classroom? And then a third theme that has emerged really showed up in our focus group discussions. So we held virtual focus groups in several countries. This is a quote here from the Southwestern Pennsylvania region where a parent was talking about how, you know, she wished that she was a little bit more educated in how to talk to parents, how to talk to teachers, that she felt, you know, teachers are kind of experts. And this to us brings up the sense of, you know, agency and parent confidence. So what are the ways that schools and maybe even parent organizations can build parent confidence to engage with teachers in schools? If you're working on this, please do submit your innovation in the 100 spotlight. The fourth theme was on trust. And so this is another example from a different parent in Southwestern Pennsylvania, but something that we saw across, you know, several of the regions in which we were doing the focus groups is this idea of trust. And here this parent is talking about, you know, wondering if maybe the teachers are looking down on her because she doesn't have the time to be an active member of the Parent-Teacher Association. And so this brings up the question of trust. And the question we're wondering is, what are ways that schools and families can build trusting relationships? We really see this as fundamental to strong parent engagement. If you're working on innovations that get at this, we'd love to know. And then finally, is this idea of demand. And so the question here that we're interested in are, what are ways that schools and parent organizations can help drive demand for education that really develops a breadth of skills or develops those 21st century skills? And the reason why I have this graph here is something that has been interesting to us is when we looked across our surveys and when we asked the question, how satisfied are you with your child's education? You'll see that the majority of parents are saying they are satisfied. So, you know, what can we do if parents are satisfied? Will that impact whether they demand change or not? If you're working on things like this, we would love to know. And then finally, I'll just close by saying we have just put out our findings about our surveys. It's up on our website. If you Google Know Your Parents in Brookings, it'll come up. And again, really excited to be part of this collaboration and looking forward to hearing from the other panelists.
Thank you so much, Lauren. And I am just dropping the link to that research into the chat right now. And don't worry if it gets buried in the chat, we will send a follow-up with all of the information that you've heard here today. But lots of exciting things. I was really, really shocked to learn that no one was that concerned about preparing their child for the workforce. I think it's so, you know, it just goes to show that these assumptions are always safe ones. So thank you.
Quickly say, Mariah, too. So individual parents did select that as an option, but when we looked overall at the jurisdiction level, there was no jurisdiction in which it was the most important purpose.
Okay, so it is on people's minds, but not as strongly as some other things. All right, thank you so much, Lauren. And we will hear from you more later. So if you have questions for Lauren, please do drop them in the chat. But now I would like to introduce our next speaker. And so please help me welcome to the virtual stage, Larry Corio. So Larry serves as the program director at IDEO and oversees the Teachers Guild and School Retool, an international community of educators who co-design more equitable futures for their schools. He is inspired by educators' abilities to work across roles and differences for the sake of students and supports them to broadly share their insights and expertise and stories. Larry is also a former high school teacher, social science researcher, and program evaluator. He has used data to tell creative and compelling stories about schools, communities. He has authored studies focused on educator preparation programs, community schools, and is passionate about community-led change in schools. So welcome, Larry. Please share with us a little bit more about your project. I think it's just recently launched this week.
Yeah, it did. Although after many, many weeks of preparation, as any projects go, right? So we just launched 2 days ago with 70 members. The whole pool of folks is about 90, but we yielded 70 members from across the globe to engage in a series of design sprints. And before we get started here, I'd actually like Lauren just to thank everybody for joining here today. We know people are calling in from all over the place. So it is a real pleasure to be with you. And I'm excited to share a little bit about IDEO's role in this exciting collaboration, which is to engage folks in the design process. So give me just a moment to share screens. I have a few slides to support a quick overview of that. And whether or not you're familiar with IDEO or the Teachers Guild and School Retool, the program that I manage, or not, I think it's always important to think about, to introduce I will use the phrase design quite often during my description here. And it's important to be clear that we should also define what we mean by design, because I think many people associate design with product design, technology, curtains, you know, interior design, buildings. And to be clear, at IDEO and in the process that we guide educators and school communities through, we mean a slightly different version of design. The way that we describe it is human-centered, right? So actually the first pillar of design, and the most important arguably, is that we start with people. We engage people in the design process and we design for and with people. Secondly, is that you don't enter a design process with a solution in hand. That feels a little bit prescriptive, right? And so this notion that you start a process with questions and you embed questions throughout the process and even might yield questions at the end of the process, getting to the right question is actually quite important to drive a really productive design process with people. And lastly, and this feels a little bit cliche, I feel like folks use this in the education space quite a bit, but encouraging folks to fail quickly and fail productively, right? And I don't mean fail like in a deficit way, but fail by way of experimentation, right? Trying something out, prototyping is a term we use, and generating insight that can help inform future iterations of whatever you're producing, whether it's a product, a service, a program, an organization, right? So it's important to be clear about that. And then design sprints is the process that we're guiding folks through. And that is really a process of guiding folks through a fast, human-centered, and equity-oriented process of engaging in the design process, right? So it could be a year-long journey. Certainly, we are engaging folks for 2 months in this process. And so it's quick. There's a lot of urgency to this, right? But there's also incredible responsibility and opportunity right now as presented by the circumstances facing schools as a result of the pandemic. This is the design question. I mentioned starting with questions. This is the question that's guiding our process, which might not feel new. It certainly feels a little bit general, but we think it's inspiring and curiosity infused. And so how might we build stronger engagement between families and schools for the benefit of all students? Again, focusing really on students being, being the agent of change at the end. These aren't new. Lauren just presented on these focus areas. These borrow directly from the Brookings research. And so parents and school representatives who are part of our design sprint process will be designing solutions that are driven, that are organized by all of the focus areas that Brookings leveled up in their research. And so obviously we reframe them into questions, right? Starting with questions is quite important, but you'll see that there's quite a bit of alignment there. We're excited to see what kind of solutions fall into each of these categories. And then a snapshot. So I mentioned at the beginning that we just kicked off this past week. We have 89 design team members across 4 different countries, Canada, India, the United Kingdom, and the US. They are organized into 17 design teams. You can imagine the amount of recruitment effort that went into this process. We are really enthusiastic about the fact that 75% are parents, guardians, or family representatives. The other 25% are school representatives. That's a really neat kind of opportunity to get folks in the same space together, people who don't normally work together. And this will be a 2-month process. The materials that we're using to support this process, some folks may be familiar with it if you're familiar with IDEO or the Teachers Guild and School Retool, but we just launched a resource called the Co-Designing Schools Toolkit, which is a resource that's used to support a process of design, of co-design, actually, collaborative design with folks across role and across difference. And that guides you through 6 different phases of the design process, starting actually with building your team, right? And then after that, setting a common vision for your work and then engaging in fairly familiar portions of the design process, an empathy stage, an experimentation stage, an iteration stage, and then a showcase stage at the end. And so feel free to head to codesigningschools.com if you're interested in learning a bit more about the resources that folks will use. And lastly is just what is going to come out of this. So what you see here are a series of screenshots from some previous work we've done in parent engagement, but we are really excited to level up solutions that are eventually going to be featured in the 100 Spotlight as well, and along with the Brookings research. And we are excited to attribute these to specific areas of the world, and really excited to think about what specific people in certain school communities are solving for, certainly in terms of family school engagement, but more importantly, how those solutions that are taking place in different parts of the world can be scaled in communities across the world, actually. So we are very excited to be engaging folks directly in this process and can't wait to hear from the other panelists about the other ways that we are collaborating with others in this process too.
Thank you so much for that, Larry, and for sharing a little bit more about what is going on. I love that you said fail quickly and fail productively as a design principle. I think that is so important, especially in today's climate. And I quickly want to say, I forgot to mention at the top of the hour, but Khatija, our head of community, has mentioned in the chat that if you have one of these solutions or if you're interested in sharing your experience with parent and family engagement, next week we are having another session that is more of a community workshop. So you will be able to share that, and we're really excited and hope that a lot of you who are here with us today will join us for that more interactive session. And with that, I want to introduce our next speaker. So hello, Yuling. Welcome to the virtual stage. Yuling Cheng serves as the ambassador and marketing director for Kidsburgh, an online resource that highlights the incredible people, organizations, and events serving families across the greater Pittsburgh region. This includes her work in hosting monthly Kidsburgh segments on various family topics on the local CBS affiliate station, as well as connecting local and international family resources with Kidsburgh audiences. In addition, Yuling is the co-producer of Remake Learning Days Across America, a festival designed for families to engage in hands-on learning together. Since its launch in 2016, 150,000 plus youth, family, care, and caregivers have participated in over 1,200 events. So in the spring of 2021, the Remake Learning Days Across America will take root in 17 regions across America. And I'm really excited because we actually worked on a project that is supporting the Remake Learning Days Across America. So with that, I'll let Yuling explain a little bit more about the project and about Kidsburgh's role in this parental engagement spotlight.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for having me here. It's so great to meet all of you across the world. I am also going to screen share and get myself into present mode. So I have the fortunate role of working for both Remake Learning Days Across America and Kidsburgh. And so I thought I would share a little bit about Remake Learning Days, a project that we also highlighted with 100. So Remake Learning Days, we really focus on this question. And the question is, what if all of us, regardless of what your role may be in your child's education or social wellness being, what if we saw ourselves as their learning allies? And what if we all cohesively worked together? And so with that, we looked at all the different places that our kids are learning. And we know it's not just schools, it's also at home, it's parks, clubs, museums. I saw someone post in the chat box that parents are educators too, and we absolutely agree with that. Parents and caregivers need to have a role at the table. So with that, that's how we developed Remake Learning Days Across America. So it's a festival that takes place for roughly a month in the spring, and we purposely schedule in the spring to help shine a spotlight on all the learning resources that are happening in local communities. This year it's taking root in 17 regions across the United States. And we currently have more than 700 events, both virtual and in-person, happening during that timeframe. We are based here in Pittsburgh, so our festival dates happen to be May 6th through the 16th, but April 22nd to May 23rd are the national dates. So with that, Kidsburgh has always been a partner with any project that has to do with highlighting parents, caregivers, grandparents, aunts, uncles, any role of a person who may be helping to make a child's life better. And so we are a media organization, and we write from news to family guides to learning education, health and wellness. We did a whole series on mental health. And we're excited to be a part of this project because what we are focused on doing is providing the storytelling of all the innovations that are surfaced by 100, the storytelling that is surfaced by the parents that are working with IDEO's design process, and highlighting the research from Brookings Institute. So between that, we will be producing a guide throughout this process at strategic moments, sharing what we've learned from parents and caregivers. And then in the fall, we will take everything that we've learned from our partners, what we've learned internationally and locally, and do 10 local community conversations with families hosted in 10 completely different areas around Southwestern PA, and hope to have these parents and caregivers take things that they learn from the spotlight, from Brookings, from IDEO, the toolkit, and actually implement it in their community. And then we will document that process in the fall. So we look forward to hearing about the journey of learning from all of you. And we hope that you will submit your innovations to the spotlight at 100.
And we are so excited to hear the stories that you have to tell. Thank you so much, Yuling. And with that, we're going to move into our final presenter before we open it up to the Q&A. So I am so excited to welcome my colleague, Christopher Petrie, the head of global research at 100, where he leads a team of researchers across a wide array of projects focused on leading innovations in education globally. He is also conducting peer-reviewed academic research on the diffusion of innovation in education. So previously, Chris has a unique wide range of experiences as an educator in 4 countries over 10 years. He is particularly interested in music and is an accomplished musician, and has taught computer science at many high schools and university institutions. So hello, Chris. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And very, very, very happy to be here. I'm just going to be taking everyone a very quick fire way through the process for submitting an innovation if you happen to have one. And also don't forget that if you know of an innovation, we'd really love to hear about it. So feel free to just drop an email or to research@100.org, and we will follow up on that. But if I think my colleague is going to be sharing her screen shortly. Yes. So the first one of the things to know is that you'll need to create an account in order to make an innovation page. And so you can just click on the login button, and then that will enable you to make an innovation page through the various channels. And then the next step is to find the spotlight page, which you can through the navigation bar on innovations, and then you scroll down to spotlights, and then you see it there, parental engagement, and you click on that. And then there's a, you can read all that information, but the key to share your innovation, you click share your innovation in the blue button, and that will start with this pop-up that you'll fill in just the preliminary information. So if we just test that, just to show you what it looks like when you've filled in that information, because there's more to come after this. Katija, my colleague, is just having a test run just to show you what it looks like. And so there's some information here that'll pop up that it's good to read through before you proceed. But just know that when you fill in that initial form, that is only the very first step. So if you just click outside of this this pop-up box, or close this pop-up box, just notice that there's a lot of fields that need to be filled out. And we'll show you an innovation page that has actually been completed and has been selected for our global collection, which is Scratch, which you may have heard of. It's one of the primary coding platforms. I just have to go back to it. And so if you click on the edit button, that's where if you have access to edit the page, that's where you edit all this information. And so notice the top navigation bar are all the different sections that need to be filled out. And just know at any stage, we're more than happy to help you if you're confused. A couple of key things to know here is that you can add multiple people as owners on that tab. And so all you need to do is get people in your team or people who want to collaborate on the page to sign up with an account, and then you can add them as an owner with the username that you've used. But all the other information is there before you can publish the page or make the page viewable to the public, because at the moment it's unpublished and you can only view it. You need to fill out all the different sections. And something I'd encourage you to do, and something that perhaps we'll do now, is actually just scroll down over what a completed page looks like, so you understand what how much information there is. But this is really designed as a very, very quick file overview of your innovation page or the innovation, to show you, you know, to tell, you know, the reader how they might, what it is and how they might get involved and what are the key figures about it. And so you can submit some media, some key media items that have come up. And also below that is the milestones, like some achievements and awards that you may have achieved during that time. So one of the key things I would encourage you to do if you're thinking of submitting an innovation page is to look at a few of the ones that have been selected for our other projects, like our global collection. And then you'll be able to see what a successful or a completed page looks like. But at any stage, again, you can reach out to us. We're more than happy to help. And I think that's all I need to go through in this session. But I hope you will either recommend something from the end of this or submit something. So we want to get as many innovations as possible and have a really great collection for the spotlight.
Thank you so much, Chris. And we've been talking a lot about you submitting your innovation or sharing your innovation. And I just want to say the deadline to do so is April 15th. So if please mark your calendars. If you are planning to submit an innovation, or if you know somebody who might be working in the space, please, April 15th, I will send it in the follow-up email along with the links and everything that has been shared in this chat. But for now, I would like to open it back up and invite all of our panelists back onto the virtual stage to answer some questions. We have had some submitted throughout the time, but if you have a question and you haven't asked it yet, now is your time to shine. I actually want to open it up with a question that we received before this session from Wilma, who asked about, you know, how do we convince parents to support and demand a new curriculum, which I think, Lauren, your research really, really touched upon. So could you give us any insight there?
Sure, absolutely. So we are, you know, really interested and motivated by, you know, being able to engage parents and families in the transformation of education so that it is something that really delivers a breadth of skills for all students. And in our research, one of the things that we're finding is that trust equation is so important. And so it does become, you know, maybe a broader way of really engaging parents and families in the whole process and not just on the one piece of transformation. And we're really interested in surfacing solutions, working with our family engagement network of 40 collaborators across 10 countries. We've been hearing some great examples of co-creation, for example, in British Columbia, where there was really a co-creation process on what is the purpose of school. And they saw a lot of track success there. So, you know, excited to see kind of what comes out of the spotlight as well.
Thank you so much, Lauren. And one other question that I want to jump on really quickly. Allison has asked Chris in the chat if it's possible to edit a current innovation page to add our work focusing on parent and career engagement. So Chris, I'll let you take that one.
Yes, absolutely is the short answer. So we encourage everyone to update their page every few months or so. But also if you have an existing 100 innovation page, perhaps think about focusing, making one that's focused on for the spotlight on parental engagement, because we're really looking for those kind of transferable solutions and practices focused on this topic and thing.
Thank you so much, Chris. An important question. So yes, please do update your page. Now I'd like to jump back, and Nick asked, how/why do you discriminate between parental and wider school/community engagement? After all, it takes a village to inspire a child. So absolutely does take a village there. I wonder if maybe Yuling, would you like to respond to this, since you do have the experience as both a parent and somebody working in this space?
Yeah, so I want to make sure I understand that question. And why do we have a line of division between parental engagement and schools? Can you repeat the question one more time?
Yeah, maybe Nick can also clarify in the chat, but why do you discriminate between parental and wider school community engagement? So where's the line? Is there a line? And should there be a line, I guess?
Yeah, so with remake learning days across America, we believe there should be no line. And so in thinking about the Remake Learning Network, it really started with educators providing innovative experiences for students in school and after school. But we realized that we were missing a really important party, and that in that party were the parents and caregivers. So we actually want to erase that line. And I think especially during the pandemic, we've seen at Kidsburgh and in the stories that we write and what we're hearing from parents and caregivers, that they are becoming more and more engaged. They have a unique lens in seeing how their kids are learning now. And so they are going to demand what they're hoping to see in the future, because every parent and caregiver is the best advocate for their own child. And so yes, we believe it is a community-oriented project. And that is why we're embarking on this study, is to really bring parents to that table and have them drive the solutions that they would like to see happen in schools and then elsewhere.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for that, Yuling. And we've got a question in the Q&A box from Georgie, who says, how might we help parents feel the benefits of education for themselves personally? So we often talk about us parents as people who either engage with the formal education process or are educating children themselves, but parents are also learners too. And they are actually co-learning and co-practicing skills with their kids almost constantly. So I think we've talked about co-creation, but does anybody wanna dive into that question of how can we help parents feel the benefits of education for themselves? Maybe Larry can share a little bit more, since we do have such a 75% of parents who are actually already taking part in these design challenges.
Yeah, sure. I mean, this is a really interesting point that we think about when we design experiences that bring together parents and educators, because there are power dynamics at play here, right? There are folks who are associated with the formal education system and folks who are adjacent to it. And you know, the responsibility goes two ways, but we are really excited through this design sprint process to elevate the expertise and honor the expertise that parents bring. I'm recalling a comment that was made earlier about how parents are becoming, in some cases, formal educators of their children or of a number of children. And, you know, over the course of the past year, and this is just reiterating actually a lot of the informal ways that parents have been supporting their students forever. Right? Parents are children's first educators. And so we are really excited to actually think about the ways that we honor not just the formal knowledge of pedagogy that teachers or administrators might have, but to think about ways to elevate the expertise of parents in terms of management, in terms of grasp of academic concepts, and in terms of facilitating learning for young people, right? And for each other. And so one principle, for instance, that we're bringing into this design sprint process is that the folks who are leading, the person identified to lead design teams, right, a team of four or five, should be a parent, right? It shouldn't necessarily be a school representative, because like I mentioned, there are power dynamics at play, and we're really excited about deconstructing those and elevating this sense of educational expertise and attributing, you know, expertise and honor to all the folks involved, not just to the formal educators.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much, Larry. And can you remind us again, when is the, you said it was a 2 month long design sprint. So when can we expect some sort of results on what you're doing now?
Sure. So we are obviously going to be generating insights and surfacing stories along the way, but our showcase is going to take place on Saturday, May 22nd.
Saturday, May 22nd, write it in the calendar, right next to April 15th, well, before or after. Oh, Anyway, thank you so much, Larry. I'm going to go to a question from Esther, and I'm not sure I completely grasped this one. So if you want to clarify in the chat while I'm reading, Esther, please feel free. But is there any chance to really change the paradigm if even this event is putting a question mark or an equation mark between education and schools? And does this not include parents in the notion of educators? So if I understand correctly, is there a chance to really change the paradigm after COVID and really create a new relationship between parents and educators? If I misunderstood, please do clarify in the chat. But Lauren, do you have an answer to that?
Yeah, I'm happy to take this one. And I wanted to say hi, Esther. We know Esther well, and she did a podcast with us at Brookings. She's the head of Parents International, and we're really grateful for all of her insights. And I think she does raise a good point. And I do want to clarify sort of the lens from which we're approaching this at Brookings and why we're so excited for this collaboration, because I think we can expand and go further. So a lot of our research is leading up to a big playbook that we're planning to produce in September. So if you want to put another thing on your calendar, towards the end of September, we're going to be releasing the playbook with all of our findings from the surveys and from the focus groups. And that audience really is a policymaker audience. It's a school administrator audience. So when I have those questions, we're kind of wondering, you know, what is it that school administrators can do, even though we certainly recognize that parents are so important and so critical to this equation. And that's why we're so happy that with the design process with IDEO, that was really directly involving parents. And then of course with Kidsburgh, we're really excited that they might be able to then to take some of the research that Brookings is doing and translate it to a parent audience, since that's not really, you know, Brookings bred and bailiwick. But I think it's a really great point, and really appreciate the reminder, Esther, that even in the work that we're doing, to always be challenging ourselves and thinking about how we use language and who we want to involve in this process, because certainly we know parents are front and center.
Absolutely, and really bringing back to the forefront the important work that Kidsburgh is doing in telling these stories. And we've dealt ourselves with kind of the difficulty in translating more research to non-researchers. So we have another question from Eric in the chat about how to engage parents from rural areas, especially in Africa and South America, where most of the communities are not aware if there are roles in what, or if there are roles in school activities. And so then we have an example of their rural area pupils are walking over 3 kilometers to school, but parents are unaware of how to cooperate with the school's administration to get food for pupils. So a question about how to engage parents from rural areas. So Lauren, has your research showed anything of that? I know you have such a broad scope.
Yeah, sure. Happy to take that question. I mean, certainly we recognize it's a challenge, but one of the things we're really excited is through our family engagement network, where we're working in the 10 different countries to hear examples and ideas that they're using. And so there are two that come to mind in the state of Himachal Pradesh in India, which is a pretty rural mountainous state, and where, you know, there is a lot of distance between schools and where people live. They've done a really great job actually during COVID being able to engage parents through these electronic parent-teacher meetings. And so they actually had about 90% participation of parents. And so one of the benefits and maybe silver linings of COVID is that, you know, we are able to sort of reach parents if they were, you know, busy, if they were working, if they couldn't come into the school, if it was far away. They now can do this in an easier way, even in a remote rural area. And then another example that comes to mind is the NGO Lively Minds that's working in Ghana and Uganda, and they're part of our network. And they've been doing some really great programming, working with parents in rural areas about that agency piece that I was talking about earlier. And so how do we build parents' confidence to know that they can, they should engage in their child's education, and they can ask questions of the teacher and the school. And so those are examples that come to mind.
Thank you so much, Lauren. And we have another question from Maria in the chat that I'd really like to ask you, Ling. So it says in her country, in Russia, the biggest barrier in engaging parents is their time. They don't feel like they have the time to invest in school. So Yuling, as a parent yourself and as somebody working in this area, how would you respond to that?
We hear about this all the time. I mean, that's the one thing that equalized all of us. There's only 24 hours in a day. And I think what we've learned from Remake Learning Days and from Kidsburgh is that kids just want parents to be there alongside them, but the parents do not need to be the experts. They really do not. We learned from Remake Learning Days in our research with the Global Family Research Project that kids reported being more excited about learning opportunities simply by the fact that their parent is there alongside them. And so I know that requires time, but it's time of just being with your child and seeing what may spark that creativity. And then from there, hopefully it leads to a journey of then seeking out other expert educators who may be able to dive further in that journey. But it's the bonding time that is so important for the child and the learning.
Thank you so much. And we've, I think, all done some bonding time, and being forced to learn at home has really, really changed and challenged that. But I'd actually like to ask a question now to Chris. So this is a question that we get a lot from innovators who are looking to submit solutions. So can you submit more than one solution, Chris?
Yes, absolutely. I feel like I'm getting the easy questions. Of course, the quality, not quantity, having that attitude as well. One important thing to note is, we measure innovations primarily on two factors, impact and scalability. And so for our criteria for impact, we do require that it has been implemented with real users for at least 1 year. So it needs to be a practice that's actually shown impact with real users. So it can't just be an idea or in a pilot stage. It needs to be in the wild for at least 1 year.
So I Chris called me out for giving him two easy questions. So I'm going to give him another question. And I'd actually like to open this one up to the entire panel here. So how do schools balance a new curriculum that addresses health, arts, science, and technology, and spirituality in the same way as language and math in the sense of developing healthy people? So this is kind of opening it up past just parental engagement, but how do we create a curriculum that really addresses all of the issues of today and includes parents in that? So Chris, I'll pick on you first.
Yeah, I mean, there's lots of ways. And I think there's a lot of the modern pedagogy is kind of looking into that. And a lot of it is breaking down the structural barriers and silos to make learning more interdisciplinary. You can take a number of approaches with that. And Finland is quite relatively well known for championing phenomenon-based learning, which is thinking about, say, like an SDG, a sustainable development goal, and thinking about how you can learn about a problem that the SDG is trying to solve across subjects. And so if we think about parental engagement with that, in terms of engaging the parents with the real world problem outside of the school, I think that would really help. But I'd love to know, have any other thoughts from the other panelists as well.
So maybe we can go to Larry next.
Sure. Thanks, Mariah, for coordinating responses here. One thing this makes me think about is the current kind of siloing of subject matter that takes place in schools, at least in many secondary schools, for instance. And I think about some of the work that we've done to intentionally bring together design teams of folks that aren't just siloed within a certain subject matter or grade level, for instance, but actually intentionally span, and how a lot of the design questions then that folks pose aren't necessarily focused on how we boost skills in math specifically, or how we infuse reading standards kind of across content areas, but they tend to be very focused on things like curiosity, things like setting goals for your, and purpose for your children's educational journey, or inspiring joy, right? Or collaboration in new ways, right? Bringing, connecting kind of in-school work to out-of-school work. And not to say that those are the things that schools should uniquely focus on, but I think about the lenses that actually educators across content areas can bring, and administrators, right, can bring into their school. And I think that there are some unifying principles, some of which you mentioned in your question, right, related to mental health and spirituality and play, that I think actually educators across subject areas and across grades can reasonably integrate into their own practice.
Thank you, Larry. I think that's so insightful. And everything is just becoming a little bit more integrated. And I think that's the direction that we should be moving in. Lauren, I wonder if you could go next.
Sure. So I'm going to draw on an insight that we have really learned from our survey research, and that was back to that purpose of education question. And so I think, you know, communities, you know, really want different things. And even within a community, parents will want different things. And so really knowing and understanding parents' motivations and aspirations is so critical when we're thinking about what is it that we want school to look like and how encompassing, you know, should it be. One of the examples that we heard in our network meeting was, you know, when we shared the survey results with one of the jurisdictions in the United States, they were so surprised to see that only 6% of parents had said that they thought the most important purpose was preparing students to become good citizens for that particular jurisdiction, because they said, oh my goodness, our focus this whole year has been on citizenship. And so we would love to be able to, you know, through our research and through this collaboration, you know, with HundrED and IDEO and Kidsburgh, be able to, you know, share some insights so that we can really get some better tools and mechanisms in place to be talking and co-creating with parents to really understand what it is that should look like.
Yeah, the disconnect there is quite surprising. And how can we better understand the wants and needs of parents? I'm actually going to move on, but I do want to ask Yuling next. So we have a question from Rachel in the chat that is about how can we help families to realize that some parental attitudes can help children to fulfill their potential and others are barriers which block their children's development? So interesting question there.
That's a tough question. It's true. So when you think about kids and youth, they are sponges and they're learning from home and they're learning from school. And so what we write about at Kidsburgh is the importance of exposure to new places, exposure to new learning events, to ideas. And there's many ways to implement that at home, whether it's through a virtual setting or an in-person setting. And so one of the things that I love that I've seen happen in this region is the idea of asking your child, you know, what is it something that you're curious about? And let's go on a journey together and let's not have any preconceived ideas as to where we're going on this journey. And let's pick two places maybe that will help us understand this better. So whether it's about a certain time in history or a certain type of activity like coding, you just go on that journey together.
Yeah, I think that really goes back to the point of parents being learners as well and needing to develop and co-creating with them in mind and their own learning. So I'm going to wrap it up with one last question, and I'm going to throw this one at Chris. So is there a possibility of introducing pet philosophy as a pedagogical ingredient? So quite a meta question, I think. How do you feel, Chris?
I love that idea. And I think children these days, they're so much more exposed to the outside world with modern technology. So, you know, encouraging that curiosity and discussion about more deeper philosophical questions, I think, especially with their parents, if possible, I think is great. So I would encourage it.
Thank you. And I am going to wrap this up, but thank you, Mary, for this last question. And she asks, how can you describe the pedagogies that parents implement to support the learning of their students? And do we have any good examples that worked out during COVID? So I want to once again take it back to, if you do have any good examples, please do share them with us. We are looking for solutions and practices that have worked. But does anybody want to answer Mary's question and describe the pedagogies that parents implement to support the learning of their students? I
can share one example that, you know, isn't even super complicated. We're working with an NGO called Young Love based in Botswana. They're part of our family engagement network. And when COVID happened, they reached out to all the parents that they work with, and they got their phone numbers. And then they started sending SMS messages to the parents. And through the SMS messages, we're able to work with the students to continue learning on math. It was program focused on math. And so it was something as simple as a weekly SMS message that went out, and then a phone call to the parent, where the parent would sit and help their child do the program. And they found that that actually did impact learning. So, you know, we can be creative about ways that parents can be involved. It doesn't always have to be, you know, super involved, but thinking about how we can do this creatively.
Thank you so much, Lauren, for making that point, because I think sometimes, especially when we think about parents and parental engagement, we're overcomplicating things. It does not have to be a new technology. It does not have to be, you know, an AI sort of way to look at things. It can be as easy as a WhatsApp solution. So I hope that for everyone listening, you really think about what is working in your community and acknowledge that it might not be a complex solution. It's a solution that is having an impact and could potentially be scalable. So thank you so much again, Lauren, for sharing that example. And thank you once again to the whole panel for really diving into this and exploring this with us. And thank you to the audience for being so active. Thank you for asking all these questions and for being engaged. And I'm so excited by all of the solutions that have already been shared in this chat. So once again, I want to say April 15th is the deadline to submit a solution. So please do take what you have learned today and either share your solution, or if you can think of anyone in your communities who are working in this space, please do share that with us. So we're going to close it out. But before that, I did mention in the middle there, we do have an upcoming event coming up that is about parental engagement. Again, it's next week, next Wednesday. And I believe Khatija has dropped a link in the chat. So if you want to talk more about this topic and you want to be heard, we really do want to provide a space for you to tell us what is going on in your community, whether it's the challenges or the solutions. We've got a really inspiring speaker. We've got some workshop planned. So please do, if you can, join us again next week for another 1 hour session. And once again, thank you so much, Lauren, Larry, Yuling, and Chris, for joining us here today and for all of the work that you're doing. And you can look forward to our shared results coming out in the end of next year. So we have a timeline on our website that'll give you an idea. The selection should be announced in September. There's going to be a lot of exciting things happening in the coming months. So please do keep up to date, subscribe to our 100 newsletter, and follow us on social media. And we can drop all those links in the chat, and expect to get an email from me tomorrow with more information and all of the things that we have chatted with here today and a recording of this session. So thank you once again. And with that, Khatija, please play us off. We're going to close with a little poll, and please do say goodbye to us in the chat. And I hope that whether it's morning, afternoon, evening, or night, you have a great rest of your day. Thank you all so much. Say it's all right.